In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and with your spirit. Hello everyone. Welcome to parishioners from St. Edward's Golders Green, and others who may also be watching this recording of Mass on Sunday the 28th of June, the feast of Saints Peter and Paul. Today's feast takes us back to the beginning of the Church. These two saints, so different in character, gave themselves to the work of continuing and developing the work of Jesus. We too are called to the same task, of furthering the kingdom of Christ on earth. Let's pause now for a moment as we prepare to celebrate the mysteries. You are sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy. You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy. You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, who on the solemnity of the Apostles Peter and Paul, give us the noble and holy joy of this day, grant, we pray, that your Church may in all things follow the teaching of those through whom she received the beginnings of right religion. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever. Amen. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. King Herod started persecuting certain members of the church. He beheaded James, the brother of John. And when he saw that this pleased the Jews, he decided to arrest Peter as well. This was during the days of unleavened bread, and he put Peter in prison, assigning four squads of four soldiers each to guard him in turns. Herod meant to try Peter in public after the end of Passover week. All the time Peter was on guard, the church prayed to God for him unremittingly. On the night before Herod was to try him, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, fastened with double chains, while guards kept watch at the main entrance to the prison. Then suddenly the angel of the Lord stood there, and the cell was filled with light. He tapped Peter on the side and woke him. "Get up," he said, "hurry," and the chains fell from his hands. The angel then said, "Put on your belt and sandals." After he had done this, the angel next said, "Wrap your cloak round you and follow me." Peter followed him, but had no idea that what the angel did was all happening in reality. He thought he was seeing a vision. They passed through two guard posts, one after the other, and reached the iron gate leading to the city. This opened of its own accord. They went through it and had walked the whole length of one street when suddenly the angel left him. It was only then that Peter came to himself. "Now I know it is all true," he said. "The Lord really did send his angel and to save me from Herod and from all that the Jewish people were so certain would happen to me." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. My life is already being poured away as a libation. The time has come for me to be gone. I have fought the good fight to the end. I've run the race to the finish. I've kept the faith. All there is to come now is the crown of righteousness reserved for me, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not only to me, but to all those who have longed for his appearing. The Lord stood by me and gave me power, so that through me the whole message might be proclaimed for all the pagans to hear, and so I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from all evil attempts on me and bring me safely to his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. You are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of the underworld can never hold out against it. Alleluia. The Lord be with you and with your spirit. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he put this question to his disciples. Who do people say the Son of Man is? And they said, some say he is John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. But you, he said, who do you say I am? Then Simon Peter spoke up. You are the Christ, he said, the Son of the living God. Jesus replied, Simon, son of Jonah, you are a happy man, because it was not flesh and blood that revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. So I now say to you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of the underworld can never hold out against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be considered bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be considered loosed in heaven. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. I'm thinking that not many of you will remember this, but in the 1950s, if you went to school in England, as I did, there would have been a day we kept called Empire Day. As the name suggests, it was to celebrate the British Empire. And we would come to school on that day, but there would be the singing of the national anthem, and then we would have an early day. We'd go home on a kind of a half-day holiday. Also around that time, when you looked up the maps in the geography books, there would be, across the picture of the world, there would be all these red parts where, coloured in red, were countries that were part of the British Empire. And we kept that and knew it as part of our tradition. By the end of the 1950s, that day, Empire Day, was contested quite a bit. And towards the end of that decade, the name was changed, and then it was moved to a date away from May, which it had been normally kept. And now, of course, hardly anybody remembers it. It came back to me, though, as I was watching the toppling of the statue of Edward Colston in Bristol, and it reminded me of that whole way that we spoke about the empire and the colonial past and things that went with that. And It just seemed as though we were reviewing our history and overhauling the way that we talked about our past. And those events in Bristol had a very direct connection, of course, with what was happening in the USA and in the city of Minneapolis and the death of George Floyd. Now, round about that time, one of the days closely connected to that day when he died, I turned on the television in the afternoon and the BBC was showing a repeat of the old film Oklahoma, the Rodgers and Hammerstein musical. Lovely film, I've seen it a couple of times before, but once you start watching one of those things, you tend to watch it to the end, which I did. And it's lovely, the music's great, the songs and the acting are very, very infectious and entertaining. But I got to the end of it and thought how innocent that film seemed in relation to what was happening both in the USA but also here in England. And the whole darkness of that past just never appeared in that portrayal of Oklahoma and the way that a state comes to be. Just as in the UK, perhaps also in the USA and other countries too, we seem to be going through a radical rewriting of our history and the story of how we came to be. Now, what does this have to do with the feast that we're keeping today, St. Peter and St. Paul? These two, and the traditions about them are very old. They go back to the earliest days of the church, and their teachings and their lives have entered into, one might say, the DNA of the church. They're part of who we are and how we tell that story of the church. I think, though, it's true to say that the way that we tell that story has come under some really quite stiff challenges in recent years. When I was studying theology, there was a debate about whether you could talk of the church as being corrupt. And it sounded quite shocking at the time to be talking in that kind of language. However, in these last few years, as we've discovered the abuses that have happened within the church, somehow the temper of that debate has changed. And coming closer to now, as we've gone through this time of the pandemic, priests like myself have been obliged to celebrate Mass on our own. And this has been pointed out in many quarters, how the church has seemed so male. And it's as if we're no longer corresponding and responding to the real issues of society and the challenges that they present. Let's just think about these two saints for a moment. Both Peter and Paul had a life before Jesus became so important to them. We have the brash, self-confident Peter, who proves to be a weak link when it comes to the trial and the death of Jesus. Paul, the fierce persecutor of Christians on the road to Damascus, has his life turned upside down. Like many other saints in the life of the church, they had, as it were, a disintegration of the story, the narrative that they'd had of their lives up to then. And then it gets put back together in the service of the Lord. That process of falling away and then being put back together, in a sense, might be happening today to our church. In this time of the pandemic, it seems almost as the church is helpless. It's been paralyzed, no longer able to function as it has been used to doing, no longer being able to speak of itself in the same kind of way? Could it be that that helplessness, that paralysis, is the prelude to something more important, that we learn to review the way we tell our story, that we find ways of presenting Jesus to the world which is adequate for our time? Jesus has called us to be missionary disciples. Could we come out of this time of the pandemic with a greater awareness of what he wants us to do and to be in our world today? Let's proclaim our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. On this day of apostolic witness, we stand united with those who have gone before us as we approach the throne of grace for our own needs and the needs of our church and our world. We pray for Pope Francis, that celebrating the solemnity of Saints Peter and Paul, and on this anniversary of his election as Pope, he may be filled with the zeal of his illustrious forebears and protected by their powerful intercession. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all the bishops, priests, and deacons of the Church, that they may be strengthened in their ministry of service and discipleship. We pray especially for our Archbishop as he celebrates the anniversary of the dedication of Westminster Cathedral. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As we celebrate the gifts and differences between St. Peter and St. Paul, we pray that we may each recognize how many different gifts of service within the Church, and offer those gifts to build it up in this place. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As we prepare for the resumption of public worship in our Church, we ask for wisdom and guidance for all involved in planning the new arrangements. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all parishioners who are sick, especially those in hospital, in care homes, or recovering at home. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray for all our departed friends and family, and for all who have died from the virus, that they may rest in peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us ask Mary, the Mother of the Lord, to pray with us as we say, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Now let us pray for a few moments in silence for our own needs and intentions. Heavenly Father, may the lives of Peter and Paul be a witness to us that even if we sometimes lack courage or true humility, you can call us once more to your service. Hear our prayer for the glory of your kingdom, which we make through Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. Blessed be God forever. Lord God, we ask you to receive us and be pleased with the sacrifice we offer you with humble and contrite hearts. Lord, wash away my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Let's pray now, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. May the prayer of the apostles, O Lord, accompany the sacrificial gift that we present to your name for consecration. And may their intercession make us devoted to you in celebration of the sacrifice. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you and with your spirit. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and just. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For by your providence, the blessed apostles Peter and Paul bring us joy. Peter, foremost in confessing the faith, Paul, its outstanding preacher. Peter, who established the early church from the remnant of Israel. Paul, master and teacher of the Gentiles that you call. And so each in a different way gathered together the one family of Christ and revered together throughout the world, they share one martyr's crown. And therefore, with all the angels and saints, we praise you, as without end we acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Vincent, our Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, and on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew and all your saints, we ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Save us, Saviour of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer we ask, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies. Graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours forever and ever. Amen. Obedient to our Lord's command, let's pray now as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign for ever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always, and with your spirit. Let's offer each other a sign of peace. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. May the receiving of your body and blood, Lord Jesus Christ, not bring me to judgment and condemnation, but through your loving mercy be for me protection in mind and body, and a healing remedy. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. Grant us, O Lord, who have been renewed by this sacrament, so to live in the Church that, persevering in the breaking of the bread and in the teaching of the Apostles, we may be one heart and one soul, made steadfast in your love. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you for being at Mass with me again today. I look forward to the day when we're actually physically together as well. The broadcasting and of the daily Mass and the reflections with Deacon Anthony, that will continue on the YouTube again this week. The church will be open again this Sunday morning for private prayer from 8 a.m. to 1 p.m. You'll be asked to follow the usual guidance about hygiene and social distancing. Do please follow the directions of the stewards who will be in attendance to help you. There'll be a limit, if we need it, of 25 at any one time. And if that limit is reached, parishioners are asked to keep their visit to 15 minutes. Please don't bring any flowers or candles to the church. And remember that there are no toilet facilities. Now, the government has now agreed for collective worship to go ahead after the 4th of July. On Friday, we received the diocesan guidelines about celebrating public Mass again in the church. We'll need to devise a plan for our own church, and we'll give more details about this next week. Food bank collection will continue at the same time on Sunday from 8 a.m. to 1 p.m. The items requested this week are as follows: bars or liquid soap, boxes of cereals, jars of cooking sauces such as pasta sauces, tinned fruits, tinned meats such as pies, corned beef, spam, etc., and deodorants for men and women. Do take care and enjoy the week ahead. The Lord be with you and with your spirit. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Mass is ended. Let us go in peace. Thanks be to God.